Good morning. My name is Ron Kim, and I'm the head of the Bishop School. I welcome all of you here, knowing that the reason for us gathering is profoundly sad and unwelcome. All those who knew Mr. J. felt his light in Balboa Park, where he served as San Diego's civic organist from 1978 to 1985. We're grateful that members of each of these communities are here with us today to give thanks for and celebrate Mr. J's life.
We gather today to remember before God our brother Jared, to give thanks for his life, and to commend him to God and to comfort one another in our shared grief. Let us pray. O God of grace and glory, we remember Jared before you. We thank you for giving him to us to know and to love as a companion in our pilgrimage on earth. In your boundless compassion, console us who mourn, and give us faith to see that death has been swallowed up in the victory of love, so that we may live in confidence and in hope, until by your call we are gathered into the company of all your saints. May your Holy Spirit lift us now above our sorrows to the peace and the light of your constant love. Amen.
Proudly call me friend. When my mother began working at Bishop's almost 12 years ago now, I began attending each performing arts production like clockwork. Whether it was a dance, acting, or a choral production, I would always take the time out of my grueling schedule as a second grader to place myself smack dab in the middle of each audience. Even then, I knew I wanted to be on stage, just like all those students, but I did not know who I was going to meet on that journey. I had seen the infamous Mr. J at each of those performances and eagerly awaited my time to work with him. In Musical Theater 8, I finally had the chance. He worked with me on the song Disneyland from the musical Smile. I remember talking to him after a rehearsal one afternoon, trying to solidify the tempo of the last few bars. If I remember correctly, he told me he would take some cue off of me, and I was so flustered he was willing to trust me, the amateur performer, with such a climactic ending. Later that year, he and Dr. Miku took over our select ensemble class, giving me yet another chance to work with him on solos and soprano parts for songs like Home Is. Yes, I was a soprano. I returned to choir second semester freshman year after I saw the year's Christmas concert and had remembered how much I adored singing. I joined Bishop Singers and claimed my new identity as a tenor. Not only that, but I changed my name and let the group know that I was actually a boy. Now, to anyone who had known me in middle school, this would have been a substantial change, but Mr. J didn't even bat an eye. He happily whisked me off with the tenor section to clean us up and get us in tip-top shape for the concert. That year, Bishop Singers was blessed with a gifted tenor section of six young men, all with profoundly different personalities. Mr. J seemed about the only man for the job, wrangling our somewhat crazy section with grace and poise, somehow always getting us to work together and blend our sounds seemingly effortlessly. I didn't return to Singer's sophomore year or junior year. That didn't mean I never saw Mr. J. I spent time with other performance groups like acting workshop and performing dance group, but he was always around to say a warm hello. I have fond memories of him waiting outside PDG shows in his signature crisp black dress pants, sleek tie, and black scarf, ready to give me a hug. He always had some praise to share with me. After I participated in Les Mis last year, I decided to audition for Bishop Singers one final time. As he would after a PDG show, Mr. J hugged me and this time congratulated me on my return to Singers. I was excited to start the year, one of three tenors and the only senior in choir. We started in sectionals early on, where I actively began working to get better at sight reading and music theory. I distinctly remember in one rehearsal thinking how excited I was to show Mr. J what I was learning, to show him how much I had grown since freshman year. We all eagerly awaited Mr. J's return to the keys. I think it is fortuitous that I came back to Bishop Singers this year. I feel honored to be one of the people that will carry on his memory in the performing arts. I had the privilege of spending almost 7 years of my life learning from him, so it seems only fitting to carry on his spirit with me through the rest of my performing arts career. It sounds selfish to say, but I wanted to share this year with him. I wanted to work with him on new material, to perform with him, to tell him when I got into college. Mr. J was a generous man. He gave selflessly and never asked for anything in return. He shared his incredible knowledge, his gift of music, his kindness, and his unrelenting joy. There was never a dull moment with Mr. J. There was always something to look forward to. I don't know if I believe in God, but I hope that Mr. J is safe, without pain, and playing the most exquisite piano for as long as he pleases. I hope that he still comes to all the performances somehow. Most of all, I hope he's being cared for the way he cared for all of us.
To my mentor, my role model, and my friend, I walk past the not yet bloomed wisteria tree and I think of you.
I drive past red Jaguars and strain to recognize a face in the driver's seat. I look at the piano and I hear and I think of the music that once filled out. And although I grieve for the memories we have yet to share, I stand here with the remembrance of your joy, of your kindness, and of your life. And I know that as I speak, your reassuring hand is on my shoulder, like it always has been. Mr. J not only has been a cornerstone of my life for the past 5 years, but he has taught me to look at this loss and remember the good. I celebrate his music, his spirit, and his compassion for others. And in this space, I feel his brilliance reflected onto all the people that he has touched as musicians, but also as humans. I have so many words to say, yet I'm silenced by the overwhelming torrent of memories that I share with him. I remember him with music and with joy, and what I've learned from Mr. J through the small shared moments, whether it is him ruffling my hair or fixing my bow tie. And I remember one moment in particular from this spring break when we watched Frozen the musical and he sat behind me. And after the musical ended, we got out of our seats. He came to me with a smile and he hugged me and said, "Watching your face light up during the show made me so happy," then planted a kiss on my forehead. This was who Mr. J was. He was a gentle man with the kindest heart and always noticing and responding with unparalleled amount of kindness. He has taught me that the simplest actions speak the loudest. And that's what makes our loss hurt even more. That there will be no more compliments, sectional rehearsals, or jokes from the man who has always been there for us. May you not only rest in peace, but may you rest in our music, our hearts, and our intentions, because he has taught me and all of us to love what you do, love who you're with, and love yourself.
Whenever I remember Mr. J, whenever I talk about him, I always mention the word sparkle. While it's no doubt that Mr. J's smile could light up a room and that his talent on the piano brought light to every part of the school and beyond our campus walls, that is not why the specific word sticks with my memories of him. While practicing for a solo in 10th grade, Mr. J told me something that has inspired me to this day, on and off the stage. After I finished singing the solo for the first time for him, he looked at me with smiling eyes and said, "That was good. You absolutely know the song, but where is the sparkle? That glint in your eye, the love for performing." In that moment, I realized that that exact sparkle was what I'd seen for so many years in his eyes every day in choir. That indescribable specialness that everyone who knew him could feel. His love for practicing piano, his love for creating music with us, his love for us, can all be summed up by his capacity to sparkle and spread light everywhere he went. My heart is breaking knowing that he isn't here with us now. I think about when he hugged me, tears in his eyes, and told me how proud he was of me right before graduation. I was so looking forward to him watching me grow up, showing him how much he had taught me about performance, about life, about being a kind, generous, and loving person. But being here, surrounded by my choir family and the bishop's community and all the people who had the honor of knowing him, I know that he is here, listening and smiling and thinking to himself how much we all sparkle.
Putting what Mr. Jared Jacobson meant to me into words is an impossible task. But I knew I'd regret if I didn't speak today, so I will try my best to share with you how I saw Mr. J. Not only was he a teacher and a mentor, He was a close friend. He made the choir room, the theater, and the whole arts program in general feel like a second home, a place where I could laugh and express myself openly. Mr. J could quite literally turn my frown upside down by just entering the room, because that's the kind of person he was. To put it simply, he made people happy. But what I will miss most about Mr. J are the times that we could have had together. One of my fondest memories of him is when I sang my first real solo in a choir concert during my junior year. After the concert ended, Mr. J came up to me, gave me a hug, and said, "You sounded amazing." With just one compliment, he gave me the confidence to break out of my shell as a shy 16-year-old boy into who I am today. I miss him because I was looking forward to meeting him again later in life, and for him to be proud of the person I became. However, though I may never get the chance to hug him after a show once more, his unconditional support and love will continue to drive me and so many others to live a life full of passion and kindness, which is something I shall forever be grateful for. Thank you.
Mr. J is the most talented man on this planet. The difference between a pianist and an accompanist is that an accompanist will catch you when you fall. Bishop Singers isn't Bishop Singers without Mr. J. These are some of the memorable quotes that previous seniors have said about Mr. J during the gift-giving section of our choir concerts. Ever since my first choir concert 6 years ago, when I was a tiny sixth grader, I fantasized about what I would say to Mr. J when I was a senior. I imagined saying my words of gratitude and receiving in return a wonderful smile and a big hug from Mr. J. Now, I will never say those words to him. I will never get that warm hug, and I will never get that happy smile. I would like to share what I might have said to him on that day of my last spring concert. It is the culmination of my experiences with Mr. J. Mr. J is not just a man who can play the piano. He is a gift from God with the purpose of blessing all who walk the path of life with him. I can certainly attest to the blessings I've received from him. It's unlikely that I would be in Bishop Singers if it weren't for Mr. J. I remember the first time I ever met the angel. He descended into the middle school choir room one day in sixth grade to substitute for Mrs. Hansen. He sat down at the piano and told us we were going to warm up. The second he struck the keys, I knew he was special. He added an exuberant flair to the previously boring warm-ups we did, at least to a sixth grader. A testament to his divinity presented itself when he single-handedly kept a group of 13 wildly rambunctious sixth grade boys focused on singing for an entire class period. I quickly became acquainted with him. Mr. J isn't just a teacher. He's a friend, and a great one. When teaching us in sectionals, he never does or says anything that makes us feel lesser than him. He's just our friend, who happens to be extraordinarily gifted at playing the piano, who gives us insight on how to sing beautiful music. When passing by him in the halls, he always greets me with a warm smile and a, "Hello, Alex." He even texted me after my ACL surgery just to make sure I was doing okay. He always ended his text with, "Love, Mr. J," or "Hugs to you and your family from Mr. J." He deeply cared about every single person in the choir, and that's why we are such great singers. Perhaps the most core foundation to our choir is the many sound effects that Mr. J plays. Whether it was a celebration sound effect after the tenors finally sang the right note, or the Jeopardy theme song while Dr. Miki was looking for a page of music, he always knew where to play them. I have been truly blessed to make music with such an extraordinary man. I would not be the person I am today without Mr. J. This contemplation on what I might have said to Mr. J during my last senior concert gives me comfort during these times. I would like to ask all of you to close your eyes and think about something Mr. J did, said, or played. Now, remember that memory for when it hurts. One of my many comforting memories of Mr. J is when we were eating shrimp during the Hawaii trip my freshman year. At the time, I didn't know how to use chopsticks, but somehow he taught me how to use them in a matter of 20 minutes. And he actually said, well, now you can tell your parents that you actually learned something over spring break, while smiling at me with that warm, gentle, loving smile that everybody knows and loves. Mr. J has left a profound impact on all of us, and cherishing his influence is the best form of remembering him. He may have departed from this earth, but he will always be with us at any time and any place, always. I know that wherever he is, he's accompanied by his beautiful music, and the people around him will be filled with joy, just like he filled us with joy. To my beloved teacher, and friend, Mr. J, I miss you, and I will always love you. Rest in peace.
Jared had such a great strength. He had such a great gentleness. And I wanted to read some lines from Shelley and then also play a theme from Schubert. But before I do that, there's something I found out about Jared just in the last week. And it was something that I almost couldn't believe, except that it came from an unimpeachable source, which is that Jared Jacobson had more lapel pins than Jim Updegraff had neckties. It's true, I know it's true because of who told it to me, but there it is. This is from Shelley, from Percy Shelley. Peace, peace, he is not dead, he doth not sleep. He hath awakened from the dream of life. He is made one with nature. There is heard his voice in all her music, from the moan of thunder to the song of night's sweet bird. He is a presence to be felt and known in darkness and in light, from herb and stone, spreading itself where'er that power may move, which has withdrawn his being to its own, which wields the world with never-wearied love, sustains it from beneath, and kindles it above. Thank you.
would like to now invite members of the community who will be singing Seasons of Love to come up and join the choir.
Season. coming in and out of choir at Bishop's for the past while. But one person has stayed here, and that's Mr. J. Since I've been in seventh grade, this man has been with me ever since then. And I don't know, I just something about him. I don't know, but I love the way he teaches. I love the way he adds these little tidbits every time we're talking about music, shotgun modulation, stuff you've never even heard of. We're all just so glad he's here and to depart his endless musical wisdom on us and his wonderful playing. I mean, have you listened to the piano for Chantal and Moulin? It's crazy. This man does it so easily. And we just want to thank him so much. So thank you, Mr. J.
Reading from the book of the prophet Micah. With what shall I come before the Lord and bow down before the exalted God? He has told you, O mortal, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you? To do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God. Here ends the reading.
Thank you all for being here today to celebrate the life of Mr. J. Before I begin my remarks, I was asked to share a few words from my predecessor, Louise Carman, who is unable to join us here today. Our musical community has lost an amazing individual, musician, and colleague. I had worked with Jared as my accompanist at Bishop's from 1997 until I retired in 2015. I can't imagine him not being here. As I heard of this tragic accident, the fond memories came flooding back to me. I really don't know a more sincere, kind, gentle, and multi-talented person. He was always there to lend a hand or two, give a listening and sympathetic ear, and was there to passionately share his love of music. I know the angels have gently lifted you to the highest heavens, Jared, my dear friend. Rest in peace. I would like to again welcome the people with us here today from all the places Jared loved and lived his life. Bishop's, St. James, First Lutheran, the Spreckels Organ Society, and the Chautauqua Institution. Thank you for coming together with us today to remember and celebrate our friend. I would also like to thank all those who joined us in singing today, and especially Steve, Aiden, and Joelle, who have been our Mr. J today. I believe music is the thing Jared loved most, and he would be extremely moved to see, hear, and enjoy all these voices raised together in harmony. It is difficult for me to come here today and talk to you about my friend in the past tense. I keep imagining he'll walk through the door in his unassuming way with his little black bag, sit down at the piano, and start up the next tune. We've performed so many times together right here in this space, Jared sitting right there, most recently at a memorial service for our friend Jim Updegraff. I never could have imagined the next time we would perform here would be a memorial for Jared. Isn't it take a while before I am no longer surprised when I look over and it is not him sitting there? There is something special we musicians share when the hands go up, the intake of breath, and our thoughts, singers, conductor, pianist, become one in the vibrations in the molecules of the air. Something from that moment is now forever missing. Jared was full of stories and interesting facts. He often regaled us at dinner outings, department meetings, or rehearsals with sordid stories of past heads of school, the Scripps sisters, interesting people he had met, or the glories of rehearsals gone wrong. I thought the best way to remember him today would be to share a few of those stories about him and the things he loved, just as he loved to share stories with us all. Many of us remember Jared for his amazing talent on the keyboard. He could play anything, literally anything, you put in front of him. And not like, let me take it home and practice a little and come back and play it for the next rehearsal. I mean, sit down, put the music in front of him, and no matter how many notes, he could play it. He really only needed to practice time if you wanted him to transpose to a remote new key on the fly, or if he was transposing something really complicated. Then he might ask for a day to make a few notes in his music before playing it in rehearsal. He was so good, one day during an early morning rehearsal, the usually very focused Jared Jacobson started cracking up in the middle of playing a very note-intensive song, the one that Nick was talking about in the video, actually, and without missing a beat, of course, because his Apple Watch went off telling him he had met his exercise goal of the day. When you were with Jared, he was 100% completely engaged in the rehearsal, the music, the conversation. There were no distractions. He made you feel like you were the center of the universe, that what you had to say was important. He made you feel loved. When he played for you, he had a way of making you feel like a rock star, or a Broadway star, or a Metropolitan Opera star. He accompanied the sixth grade class of beginning violins playing Twinkle Twinkle Little Star with the same gravity and musicianship as a sophomore preparing an all-state audition, a senior preparing college auditions, or a visiting guest artist performing for the entire school. He allowed and enabled us to be the best musicians we could be and celebrated every success. A text from Jared, April 28th. 11:06 p.m. post-choir concert. Just got home from getting my church ready for tomorrow. My wish for you tonight and the rest of the weekend is wine, chocolate, warm hugs, and a lap full of Yorkie as you reflect on the extraordinary accomplishments of your musical children these last many days. I couldn't be more proud of you. They say great artists exemplify empathy. That is the characteristic Jared defined. Whether it was a sweet treat on your desk, a card, a poem, a text message, baked goods, a sticky note, an arm around the shoulder, or a straightened bow tie, Jared cared about people, knew when they needed something, and gave them the gift of being loved. His empathy allowed him to always act in service to the music, regardless of how many notes. He gave equal importance to the rubato in Brahms or an ornament in Handel as he did to the swing eights in the You'll Be Swingin' Christmas medley. Music and empathy fueled his life. Another text. Have just seen the first half of an astonishing concert by the Hamburg Ballet. The music is Bach, the Chopin Nocturnes, and Simon and Garfunkel. Another half to come, and I am already weeping. Love, Jared, in absentia. Jared's love of music led him to the many places he loved and lived his life. While it is with sadness and loss that brings us together since his passing, I've had the privilege of talking to some of his friends from those communities and of sharing some memories of Jared in the ways we are connected through him. One of the ways is through those choral warm-ups. Jared was a master of the choral warm-up and loved to mentally challenge us all at the beginning of rehearsals to make sure our brains were turned on for music making. He'd start with, okay, we're gonna sing the ABCs, but leave out every letter in Kornichuk. Or, this side of the room is gonna be the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5s, that side of the room is the 8, 7, 6, 5, 4s. Ready, here we go. He loved sharing choral warm-ups between his Chautauqua choir and our bishop's choirs, and he would come home from the summer full of new choral warm-ups for us to learn, mostly crazy new tongue twisters for us to master, whether it was Black Glass Backsplash, sing that up the scale 8 times fast, Irish Wristwatch, Scottish Sushi, or something about petunias and pink and purple polka-dotted pots that I never quite got. He came back from Chautauqua each summer telling us stories of our warm-ups he had shared with his choir there and teaching us new ones from his Chautauqua choir members. Jared loved Chautauqua, and for years I got to hear about the drama of the building of the new amphitheater from planning through completion. Finally, at long last, a message from June 30th, 2017. Hi, thinking of you, I am over the moon about my new concert hall here. It has amazing acoustics, and I couldn't be more pleased with it. And the backstage spaces are even better. After 50 years of rehearsing choirs in a corridor with windows that either didn't open or didn't close, but not both, my new choir room with its hardwood floors, 2.5-story ceiling, and jaw-dropping views of Chautauqua Lake, and climate control, and seating for 92 is an unbelievable dream. My love to the Globetrotting Scholar and her little dog, too. It would be impossible for me to count the number of times Jared left a late rehearsal or performance at Bishop's, only to drive downtown to take care of something at First Lutheran. Sometimes an unexpected flood, other times to help someone in need, many times to decorate. Jared loved to decorate for the holidays, especially Christmas. He would send pictures sometime around midnight with a short text, "Just finished decorating my other home." And there would be pictures of the sanctuary of First Lutheran bedecked with poinsettias. He loved Christmas, and we shared the guilty pleasure of Hallmark Christmas movies. We concocted a plan that never came to fruition to have a performing arts department Hallmark Christmas movie night. Unfortunately, the closest we got was texting back and forth during the movie. Jared, I've become addicted to these F*** Hallmark movies. Help me. Me, have you watched the Netflix ones yet? Jared, you're an enabler. That's what you are. Did you know that Hallmark has a website for ordering clothing to wear while you're watching their movies? Perhaps we should talk to the PAC about this for our concerts. Me, sounds like grant money to me. Jared, I suppose we could get Tripp's office involved. Jared's love of decorating for the holidays reached a pinnacle last year on Halloween. In what he admitted was a last-minute impulse buy at Home Depot, he purchased a giant 7-foot-tall, blow-up, light-up, 2-headed dragon called Fire and Ice. One head was breathing red light-up flames, the other blue. He snuck into the choir room before anyone would be there and set it up in front of my music stand. He completed the scene down to the last detail with Harry Potter music on the director's stand. When I came in and found it at 7:30 on Halloween morning, I texted, "I guess we won't be needed at school today. Our sub is here." Jared, well, I thought fire and ice were the two best teaching methods. When all the neighborhood kids wanted their pictures taken with it in front of my house that night, he said he considered it a wise investment. It occurred to me that maybe one of the ways Jared had of putting a little holiday decorating spirit into each and every day was his appropriate choice of lapel pin. To say Jared had an appropriate lapel pin for every day of the year would be the understatement of the year. He had an appropriate one for every occasion of every day of the year in multiple colors to match whichever color dress shirt, tie, or sweater he chose to wear that day. If he wasn't wearing a button-down shirt, it was on the collar of his turtleneck, and he was proud to show them off. He texted a selfie on July 6th, right before playing the Harry Potter concert at Chautauqua, showing me he was wearing the Gringotts Bank vault key lapel pin I had sent him to P.O. Box J, Chautauqua, New York. If there was something Jared may have loved as much as music or decorating for the holidays, it was sweets, especially chocolate, dark chocolate especially. It is rumored that he even accepted it as payment for playing weddings. Every time we could escape off campus to go get a cup of coffee, because he didn't actually drink coffee, but he was always up for an adventure, we ended up at Sugar and Scribe, ogling the sweets in the display case. Inevitably, we walked away with some kind of fancy coffee for me and something chocolate for Jared, or he would get a gift for a friend. Most often, something chocolate and a gift for a friend. I think Jared's love of sweets must have been a motivating factor in his developing his baking skills. Every potluck party or gathering, Jared was assigned desserts. He was an expert after many years of practice. His story was that growing up, he and his sister were in charge of meals. She developed a talent for the main courses, and he became the baker. Whether it was salted caramel ice cream for a department party, a pavlova for a Thanksgiving get-together, or red velvet cupcakes for Bel Canto to match their dresses, it was all deliciously decadent. Just one more way Jared had of showing his love for us. It does not escape me that when I can begin to imagine music at the Bishop's School without Jared as the department chair, it'll be my job to hire someone new. How does one write that job description? Seeking. Collaborative artist. Pianist and organist who can play anything from Bach to Bohemian Rhapsody. Must be kind and generous of spirit. Someone who will make this school, its teachers, students, and community a top priority. Must recognize when someone needs a pick-me-up, phone call, funny card or note, piece of chocolate, or hug. Will be expected to function as a role model, caretaker, mind reader, best friend, co-conspirator, and confidant. Job responsibilities include, but are not limited to, being the plus one at Bishop's events, functioning as the gregarious sidekick to socially awkward introverted choir director. Remembering the music stand that the director always forgets to bring to the gym for Thanksgiving and Christmas chapel. Basically, looking out for all of us and making sure we are prepared for all of the challenges we face. Must be able to fix the tenors and the basses. Must not hog the piano bench when playing duets and be able to seamlessly switch off playing vocal warm-ups with the director without missing a beat. Must have a sense of humor and keen wit, be an amiable traveling companion, and enjoy going on all the Disney rides. Tech savvy is a plus. Those who are not snappy dressers need not apply. At the Chautauqua Memorial Service for Jared, Right Reverend Robinson spoke about heaven. If it's true, I'm sure many of us imagine Jared up there taking charge of the heavenly choirs of angels leading from the organ, but I think not. In a text message from September 3rd, 2018. What a boring day. No church services, no choirs to rehearse, no classes to teach, no concerts to give. Were it not for the absence of Basil Martinis, this must be what heaven is like. Save a few for me, my friend. We will have a lot of catching up to do.
Chambers lie true, stripped of poet's gloss. Words alone are vain and vacant, and my heart is mute.
In response to aching silence, heard voices,
and my soul finds primal eloquence and wraps me in song. Wraps me in song.
I want to thank Dr. Makiew for your strength over the last couple of weeks, for comforting your students and minding their grief at the same time that you move through your own, and for all that you have done to make beautiful music for us this morning. And I know that Jared's heart is full, bursting full of joy and pride and thanks. Let us pray. Jared, our beloved friend, mentor, and colleague, we entrust you to God. Go forth from this world in the love of the one who created you, who loves you, who knows you by name, and who now receives and protects you. May light perpetual shine upon you. May you rest in peace and rise in glory, where pain and grief are banished, and life and joy are yours forever. Amen. And now receive a blessing. This blessing is a blessing that I've been using this year in chapel. I think it's fitting this morning. Do not be dismayed by the brokenness of the world. All things break and all things can be mended, not with time, as they say, but with intention. So go, love intentionally, extravagantly, and unconditionally. The broken world awaits in darkness for the light that is you. Amen.
Let us go in peace to love and serve one another.